My name is Dan Mann. I'm the Director of Financial Aid at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, and I have the privilege of serving as the 2015-16 NASFA National Chair. On behalf of NASFA, ESFA, and NYSFA, I'd like to formally welcome those of you who are gathered here at New York University, as well as those who are joining us via webcast, to the Postsecondary Education Financing Forum. We are pleased to see such a diverse audience comprised of financial aid administrators, policy colleagues, and those from the financial industry, and believe that the variety of backgrounds in the audience set up nicely for a healthy, fruitful discussion on the important topics of college, cost, borrowing, and indebtedness. For those of you who may not be aware or familiar, NASFA is a nonprofit higher education association based in Washington, D.C. that represents 20,000 financial aid administrators and nearly 3,000 colleges and universities across the country. NASFA member institutions serve 9 out of every 10 undergraduates in the United States. We advocate for public policies that increase access and success for low-income students and serve as a forum on financial aid issues. Today, we are partnering with our colleagues from the Eastern Association of Student Financial Aid Administrators, as well as the New York Association. Kelly Morrissey from Mount Wachusett Community College is the ESFA president. Carrie Cooper from SUNY Canton serves as the NYSFA president. In addition, we have 2014-15 NASFA National Chair Eileen O'Leary from Stonehill College, as well as the 2016-17 NASFA Chair Lisa Blazer from the University of Texas at San Antonio. And please reach out to any of us if you have questions throughout the day. Most of NASFA's policy events are held in D.C., but given this topic, we are pleased to be hosting this event here in the nation, in New York City, our nation's financial capital. This forum will explore various aspects of the financing of post-secondary education, including cost, the role of the federal student aid programs, student borrowing and indebtedness, and repayment. You will hear from a variety of speakers, including those from the financial industry, policy analysts, faculty, and practitioners themselves. For those of you who are Twitterers, we encourage you to post throughout our event today, and our Twitter handle is listed here at the top of the screen. It's hashtag NASFA in NYC. At this time, I would like to introduce our first speaker of the day, Martha Kanter. Martha is the executive director of the College Promise Campaign in Washington, D.C. She is a former U.S. Undersecretary of Education and a senior fellow at the Steinhardt Policy Institute for Higher Education here at New York University. Martha, we are grateful to you and New York University for allowing us to utilize this wonderful space, and thank you for being our host today. At this time, I'd like to invite you to provide a few opening remarks, and please join me in welcoming Martha Kanter.
Thank you. I don't know if you, can you see me? Okay. I'm really thrilled to be here. I have a few slides. They're giving me 10 minutes to tell you about what I'm doing now, having left the government in December of 2013 and having come to New York University to teach the politics of higher education and all manner of college affordability challenges that we have. So I want to thank you for being here. And for enjoying a little bit of Washington Square today. If you take a break or you have a little time after the meeting, there's a lot of music out there and the students are going to have graduation next week, so there's a lot of excitement downtown. I prepared a PowerPoint to just tell you about something that's happening around the country that started 10 years ago in Kalamazoo, Michigan. A philanthropist came and put quite a lot of money, millions of dollars, into an irrevocable trust. And he said that any student who graduated from Kalamazoo High School could go to any 2 or 4 year public institution in the state of Michigan. Later on, they added an approved list of privates to really protect against some of the bad schools you've read about for many years. And that's been in place for a decade. And it's generating interest, it's helping students make college choices. And another benefit of that early program was that it was, you know, Kalamazoo was sort of devastated, you know, by all the economic recession challenges that we had over the last 15 years. And it really rebooted the entire community in terms of economic development. They had industry moving in, and they had much better and much stronger community engagement because it caused, the cross-sector partnerships that I think strengthened local communities. So they had, once they had the Kalamazoo Promise, education, business, government, labor, students themselves, and the community philanthropy really kind of worked in relationship over these 10, now 11 years. They just celebrated their 10th anniversary last year. In the fall in Washington on October 24th, we're going to bring a lot of Promise programs together in DC. They've never come to DC, but this program has sprung up over the country in very different ways. So there's not one College Promise model. There are now, when I started looking at this after I came to NYU, I sort of came to NYU and studied three buckets of research. One was College Promise research. The second was children's savings accounts, because I really have, and I think you share that with me, a pre-K through 20 agenda that you can fix one problem in college, we can get students housing and financial aid and so on, but if we don't really think about the entire pipeline, I think we've missed the boat for the next generation and the next and the next. So children's savings accounts, could they be leveraged to college savings and college affordability and financial education in some way if they had a relationship with College Promise programs that were sprouting up? And then the third bucket is really what I call behavioral incentives. You might call it educational strategies or educational interventions, but what are the evidence-based things that we can do that you know full well, aid like a paycheck, for example. Is that possible? Is that a big headache by changing out some of the technologies on your campuses? But, some of the early research is saying that if students get a payout, more than once or twice in a semester, they may spend better and they may, make the federal aid that they get last longer. So that's just one of many examples in the behavioral intervention side of things. And I was trying to, our president, our new president of NYU has just announced a big college affordability task force. And I was meeting with their provost. I said, why don't you ask the city if they can get, all the students at CUNY and SUNY and the privates some kind of really, reduced more than the student rate for transportation. Do things like, and I said, do you have a plan with alumni where alumni are housing these students? There's just a lot of more that we can do. And so I know how overwhelmed you are because I worked with our financial aid folks for years at De Anza College and then Foothill De Anza. So that was, many, many years of trekking through the regulations and all of the burdens that you face every day. And at graduation, that's the greatest time because that the financial aid has really changed people's lives. So I'll probably have 5 minutes left, but what we're doing with the Promise, let's see, 5 minutes, yes. She's right. When I looked at this in January of 14, we had about 50 College Promise programs identified around the country. We launched a campaign. We set up a 501c3 last summer. We launched a campaign on September 9th. It kicked off with the president actually went to Macomb Community College and kicked it off with a board, an advisory board that we put together, not a governing board, an advisory board, to help us lead it forward. And today I can tell you there are about 130 Promise programs. So we've added, over the 2.5 years, it went from 50 to 130, but 30 of them have taken place in September. And there's pretty much a new one every day. Santa Barbara launched one last week. We've got one in Arkansas, one in Oklahoma, 13 in California, and they are very different. So that's where your expertise could be tremendously beneficial. People are putting these things in place, probably with disconnected conversations in their local communities. I think the easiest ones are the Kalamazoo. Can you find a billionaire or a multimillionaire who plunks down an irrevocable trust? And I said, we could do this whole thing for the country. with 53 billionaires, because Wyoming, that only has 500,000 people, doesn't need a whole billionaire to invest in Wyoming college students' affordability. But, you know, they might need a 15% of a billionaire, whereas California might need three of them, three of the 53. So if you find billionaires, send them to me. There is one in New York. I'm really glad to see Mark Zuckerman here. Stand up, Mark, so they know who you are. Mark runs the Century Foundation in New York, and you probably have read he had Free College Debate. He was the first one to really engage. You know, what does it mean to talk about free college? It really resonates with first-generation students, families, people that maybe didn't think it was possible, and there are far too many in the country that think it's just not possible, and it's not for me, and I don't have family, and you know this very well. So he had a big debate on that, was very successful in New York, and you should probably follow a lot of the research that they're coming out with. So what we're wanting to do is build widespread support for College Promise programs. We say that we're starting with the community colleges, but not limited to. So Kalamazoo goes all the way through, 2 and 4 year, public and private, on an approved list of privates, and that's one of many models. There are some states, like Tennessee, that have gone just for community colleges. It's a last dollar program, you know what that means. They'll use federal and state aid, but what they did was very interesting. They took unallocated lottery funds and or changed the lottery investments and put them in an irrevocable trust. So we're having a conference in June at ETS in New Jersey, and you know the name of the conference is Financial Sustainability, College Promise Financial Sustainability Conference. To say, you know, what are the tools we could use to actually count on dollars being there so the schools aren't jerked around all the time with less money, more money. And it's really, really hard to think about sustainability. But when Governor Haslam put this money into a trust, you know, he's really saying it'll grow interest. We can use it for these purposes. Yes, you know, the Tennessee legislature could change tune. They could say no more at some point. But in Kalamazoo, it's really sort of fixed. So, and it's 10 years old. So we've got a leadership board. We've got Republicans and Democrats leading it, which is a good thing. Governor Geringer from Wyoming and Dr. Biden from Washington, D.C., who you've probably seen on TV. We've got different committees, business, labor, students, and so on. I have both NEA and AFT on our advisory board. We've got JP Morgan Chase, all kinds of people that don't normally talk to each other, which is sort of how we designed this, to bring unlikely people together to talk about this. We've got a big research and policy effort. So University of Pennsylvania, they have a program called AHEAD, the Alliance for Higher Education and Democracy. I've asked them to look at all 130 and help us categorize them. So if people come to you in your local community, you can, in New York, say yes to education is a big one, and big promise program in Buffalo. There's another one, the Syracuse Promise. We have a database now of these 130, and we're breaking down the database to look at, you know, how are they investing the money? What are the eligibility criteria? Are they merit? Are they need-based? What is the, you know, what are the models? And then over time, we're hoping to really optimize the best models. So I can't go through all of this. I've talked a little bit about this, but we are going to give you the PowerPoint if you want it. Justin Drager, who's been, you know, a tremendous support and worked with for a long time through NASFA, has the materials in the PowerPoint. If you want to know more, you know, let me know. I said I'd be up here for 10 minutes, and I just want to thank you all for the work that you do. It's very important that your expertise join these conversations locally. Because as I said, it's from, you know, Oakland, California. Boston just announced a couple of weeks ago they're setting aside dollars to do this. Will the dollars be sustainable? Will they be mapped to federal and state aid? What are institutions doing with their own scholarship funds? And how can it all be put together to benefit more students who thought college wasn't possible or who needed that emergency grant fund, and this could take the place? So I want to thank you for the time, and look forward to seeing all of the things that you do in your local communities. It's so critically important. Thanks, everybody.